Everyone for coming out. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Mike Cole. I work in the admissions office. And I am about 1/75th of the reason that most of the students are here. That's how much my opinion is valued. We've got a great program set for you. Great cause, which Phil and Nicole will speak about. So what I'm going to do before bringing them up is let you know who is on the NetterNotes executive board. So Tracy Bourne, Kat Woolley, VP of Music, Joe Weatherall, VP of Finance and Records.
Hi, Tito!
President Phil Labrius. Vice President and VP of Interprofessional Relations and Logistics, Nicole McAmis. So we'll have them come up. One of the things, because for some reason, I don't know, but some students had said they heard I was going to be roasting people. Maybe, I don't know how to explain that, we'll see. Just to sort of get it off to start now, because I think everyone's got a great sense of humor, and we all understand that this is a great cause, and things that are said are staying in this room. So the first is, I'm very fortunate that a couple of people who are very special to me are here tonight. And while you may get my pleasure for some part of the day, they get to live with me. So I wanted to point out, over here, if you could put your hand up, this is my first wife, Kristen. This is our daughter, Gabby, who, if you exclude our son, is my favorite child. And so I'm so pleased that they came out. It's when Phil had come to our office and he was looking for talent, and I realized we've got John, who's a great musician, we've got Tony and Charles, great musicians. I realized I really don't have that much talent, but I'm not sure if you know, but the number one fear is supposedly a fear of public speaking. And so, maybe it's not a talent, but the thing is, an even bigger fear than public speaking is speaking in front of a very accomplished group. So when Phil told me it would be first and second year students, I felt very relieved. I'll turn over to Nicole and Phil, and we'll see you back in just a little bit.
That's his talent, and he was very happy to host our show for today. But
before we continue,
okay. So just like to thank everyone for being here. Without everyone else, buying tickets. Thank you for listening to all of our announcements and our emails. But I'd like to thank everyone. So the Frank Chan School of Medicine for having us and hosting us. We'd also like to thank. Dr. Yackel for being there at the admissions office every time when we say hi to him. He's giving us a lot of inspiration for things. Thank you for the office of Dr. Pham, the Office of Student Affairs, for, especially for Lisa Carroll and Roberta Carlone, the audience, for having us like really.
Thank you also for the NetterSGA Finance Committee, so for approving all the people we're eating, all the setups, all of these flyers, so thank you again. It's for the Good Guy University Music Department. For we'll give an introduction to him later, but this is Dr. Meyer, and Professor Angie Dong, who are our music advisors, and our advisor here at Netter is Dr. McHugh. And although he cannot be here, we do have a photo booth. We'll do it next time. Sadly, can't make it because of the storm outside, but you know the show must go on. And last but not least, thank you again for Edgar. He's going to be around taking photos of everyone, recording the entire event.
So thanks guys again for coming. I just want to give a brief introduction to Dr. Sprengelmeyer. I actually spoke with him quite a few months ago when I came to him and I was like, well, I have this idea of, you know, Phil and I have an idea of implementing something where music and medicine is integrated together, and he was really on board about that and we got really excited on it. So he lovely introduction here. He is currently the chair of the Visual and Performing Arts Department at Quinnipiac. Something wonderful was that he was awarded the Doctor of Musical Awards degree in guitar performance from the Peabody Conservatory at the John Hopkins University, and who is the second individual in the history of the nation's oldest music conservatory to earn that degree. So, everybody, this is Dr. Sprengelmeyer.
Hello. How are you? I guess I came to this in part because in my studies at Johns Hopkins University, I became aware of the connection between physicians and musicians at that time. It was kind of a surprise to me, to be perfectly honest. You know, being in a major conservatory like the Peabody Conservatory, there's just concerts happening all the time. And most of the students who were there, we'd all attend concerts and listen to what people were playing and, you know, our friends, but sometimes people we didn't know as well. And I remember I went to a piano concert one night, and this gentleman played wonderfully. It was a beautiful performance. And afterwards, I went up to him and asked him who he was studying with, assuming that he'd study with, you know, Ann Schein or one of the other great, you know, faculty we have in piano there. And he said, "Oh, actually, I'm from the medical school. So I just study with one of the students who's a student of one of the major performers." And I was really shocked because he plays so well. I mean, he played as well as pretty much any other music major. You know, if you told me that he was a graduate student in piano, I wouldn't have been at all surprised. You saw that over and over. You know, I saw that connection constantly at the Peabody Conservatory. People who were taking lessons and people who were playing the cello or the piano or the violin at a very high level. And I was always kind of shocked by it because you guys are kind of busy, aren't you? And it takes a lot of time and effort to play a musical instrument very well. I mean, it's not something you can just jump into and say, "Oh, I'm going to practice for an hour a day." That really doesn't do it, you know, if you're preparing a whole hour's worth of music. So I became aware that there was some connection there in my mind between medical students and between musicians. And I'm not sure I've ever quite figured it out. Maybe I've come a little closer after I was given the assignment of doing this lecture for you guys. I won't talk for too long. I'd rather play my instrument. But what I did, being the incredible scholar that I am, is I did a simple Google search, of course. And I was met with this first, this horrible graphic actually, but I stole it anyways, of a French horn, and it was an article in the Boston Globe, and it was all about the Boston Herald, but it was all about this connection between musicians and physicians, and I was really interested in that. But then as I started going through that first page of Google results, I was even more surprised because, well, I think these were the first five entries on that Google page, right? And you know, one of these things, you begin to see a pattern of a clear connection between physicians and musicians. 50% of the audiences at BSO concerts are doctors. Now that's a little bit strange because I believe there are more people who have terminal degrees in the Boston area than just about anywhere else in the world because of that, you know, all those major schools that are there. So maybe we can throw that one out. And then they are MDs and PhDs as well. I know PhDs don't count. I can say that in this crowd and not get attacked. My school, not so much. Over 70% of doctors, however, now we are talking medical doctors, have received musical training. That kind of surprised me, but not terribly, because you know these are usually students that are very high achieving, and we might assume that they would take lessons at some point. And by the way, that was in a study done by Alan Speer from the Harvard Medical School, who wrote a whole book about that whole connection as well.
And then the next one was another Harvard Medical School professor who wrote a book about the connection between these two, and she called it Scales to Scalpels. There's a lot of really fun little plays with words you can do here. I'm not sure they're funny, but they're fun. Then there was another one, which was Music Lessons, What Musicians Can Teach Doctors. Probably not much, to be honest, but maybe. But the next one, this was a really interesting one for me. This was from Stanford University, which is Music and Medicine, The Art of Listening. And this was a concert and lecture series. They had a doctor that was also a musician who came, and they'd have a performance with the St. Louis String Quartet for the Stanford medical students, and then they would have a lecture about that Haydn String Quartet, and they'd talk about how it can be connected to their studies in medicine. So that was a pretty interesting one. And then what doctors can learn from musicians, this was in the New York Times just recently. So you begin to see that there certainly is some connection here. There certainly is, I think, a just kind of a natural connection somehow between the two. And I started to wonder what that connection could possibly be. Now, the logical thing for me to do would have been to read all of these, but I didn't do that. I just came up with my own ideas. Hey, well, mine are as good as anyone else's, right? I really feel like part of it is, you know, this idea of putting theory into practice. I think, you know, physicians, largely, when you're practicing medicine, it's much like a performance. You know, you're forcing, and I guess I'm thinking of a surgeon especially, and probably doing this because one of my best students ever was a surgeon. And, you know, there was this automatic connection. He could automatically, you know, I remember when he was going to perform. He said to me, "Oh, it's going to be okay. I know what it's like to be under pressure and have to do something with your hands," and that was interesting to me because I think that's a real natural connection that you can make between the two. You know, when you get out on stage and you're nervous and you're in front of the audience, like I'm about to be in a second when I perform on the guitar, and your hands shake a little bit, right? That's an automatic response. It's just this little tremble in your hands, and boy, when you're trying to play a musical instrument, that's not very good, is it? And I'd imagine if you're trying to do a complicated surgery, it's even worse, right? So there's certainly a natural connection there, I think. You can study it all you want, but can you make it work on stage? And that's always the big question. During performances, major mistakes are unacceptable. Minor mistakes happen all the time. I mean, I don't know if that's true. Probably, I hope it's not true for surgery. But it's absolutely true for music. I mean, whenever I play a piece, the next time I play a piece perfectly without making a single mistake will be the first time I do that. It's never happened for me in my life. But it's okay, because you learn how to manage those mistakes. You learn how to, you know, something went slightly wrong. You learn how to not make it really wrong, you know? Not go down that path even further. You somehow correct that error and move on with life. And maybe people don't even notice by the time you're finished. And I think that's, once again, you know, that practicing for perfection. You know, I'm always, when I'm practicing, saying to myself, I want to practice and be perfect. And then when I walk out on stage, I want to accept the fact that I'll never be perfect. It's a really interesting way to think. It's a really difficult thing for a lot of people to do. But I think as musicians, it's something that we kind of naturally begin to accept. It's just the way things go. And I think that's also true for a lot of the medical arts as well. Mental and physical challenges. I've always been really interested, and I don't know, maybe this is just me, but I've always been really interested by anything where I have to do something physically, but it's actually the mental part that's the most difficult to get over. So that thing that I just said before, I guess I'm kind of saying the same thing twice here. I love to play golf. Ridiculous sport, stupid sport. The dumbest sport on the face of the planet, honestly. You know, you're playing a great round of golf, and then all of a sudden you hit a horrible shot. And then, you know, can you get over that? And just kind of move on and get past the mental aspect. That to me has always been the really interesting part of golf. The rest of it I don't really care much about. But I'm really fascinated by that idea. And I think that, once again, this is something that, you know, connects directly to the thing. And what I always think to myself, as far as mental and physical challenges, if I'm on stage and I play a wrong note, if I, in a second, my fingers don't feel right, they won't, because I always feel like the first 10 minutes of any concert, I feel like, oh God, I hope it works. You know, like, oh, what's gonna happen? Are my hands gonna be good tonight? Am I gonna remember the piece? You know, there's all these thoughts that go through your mind. And about 10 minutes in, I'll start to feel better and better. So in those 10 minutes, how do you make it work? You know, how do you overcome that? And for me, the answer is always on the bottom there, which is I focus only on the music. Everything is gonna be okay when I play here in a minute, so long as I'm focused on the music. If I start getting concerned about the way I look in front of you, then it might not be okay. Then I might run off the stage and cry in a room somewhere because I'm freaked out that you guys won't think I'm good. But if I'm focused on that central idea of the music, and in this case, I just put in patient there because I assume that would be the equivalent for you guys. You know, if you're focused on the patient, you're focused on what you really need to do, I think there's some wisdom in there that can be gained and that I think are shared, once again, between music and medicine. And then I think this is a huge one, too. I've consistently been surprised. I had a number of MDs that were my students, and I've consistently been surprised at how creative they were. I don't think I should have been surprised, in all honesty, but I guess I thought to myself, well, you know, you're a medical doctor. You studied for all these years. You have all this book learning, and maybe creativity is not really going to be your thing, right? You have a lot of other stuff in your brain going on. But certainly, just as music requires creativity, I think, and you know, how do I know? I'm not a doctor. I'm not that kind of doctor. I think creativity is always the basis for doing anything extremely well. And I think that certainly is a connection, once again, between music and musicians. So that's my take on it. You don't have to believe it. I don't know. I didn't read anything about it. But I got to say, I really am excited about this idea. I was really happy when Nicole contacted me. It's been my experience. I've been teaching college now for way too long. 25 years or something. And it's been my experience that the best ideas always come from the students. I can come up with a great idea. It could be a wonderful idea. I could come up with this idea, and it would not have worked out at all well if it hadn't come from the students themselves. Because you always get a lot more engagement from the students. It's a lot more exciting. It's a lot more something that, well, is owned by you guys instead of owned by the faculty. And I think that's a really important thing. So I'm always very, very happy when a student's excited, when a student's into doing something, and then makes something like this happen. I mean, this is a lot of work, if you guys don't know. Putting on a music show, trying to get people to sign up for to perform, then trying to put a performance schedule together, who goes when, how long is each piece, how are we going to get the food out front, how are we going to get the room. I mean, this is all stuff that is a kind of a ridiculous amount of work, to be honest with you. I do it all the time. It's really hard. And it's great to see that there's a student who, once again, is a medical student, who I would assume is somewhat busy, but takes the time to do something like this. It's a really a wonderful and exciting thing. And I think it's something that's going to be great for the music program and great for you guys as well, at least I hope. Okay, so I'll shut up now and play the guitar. So I'm going to play for you a piece by Fernando Sor. Fernando Sor was a 19th century classical guitarist, and he actually had a very kind of fortunate career in a weird sort of way. He was part of the, he sided with the French when Napoleon attacked the Spanish, and they actually were in Spain for quite a period of time, and he worked for the Spanish during that period of time. Well, after the French then left Spain, he kind of wasn't really welcome anymore. So he then moved to Paris. And this was the fortunate part, because in Paris at the time, in part because of Fernando Sor, something began which was called guitaromania. And people were just fascinated by the classical guitar, and Fernando Sor was one of the first people to really start writing these really famous works for the classical guitar. And in essence, what ended up happening is we have an interesting piece. It's a kind of a Spanish piece. It certainly sounds Spanish, and it's, you know, the scales and everything else, but it's got a certain French sensibility. I don't know, kind of like flan with a glass of champagne. If you'll understand, I'll just play it, I don't know. Thank you.
Dive right in, follow my lead. is all I owe, and in your eyes you're mine. Baby, I'm dancing in the dark with you between my arms, barefoot on the grass, listening to our favorite song. When you said you looked a mess, I whispered underneath my breath, but you heard it, darling, you look perfect tonight.
Well, I found a man stronger than anyone I know. He shares my dreams, I hope that someday we share a road. I found love to carry more than just my secrets, to carry love, to carry children of our own. We are still kids, but we're so in love, fighting against all odds. I know we'll be alright this time. Darling, just hold my hand, be your guy, you'll be my man. I see my future in your eyes. Baby, I'm dancing in the dark with you between my arms, listening to our favorite song.
When I saw you in that dress,
looking so beautiful, I don't deserve this. You look perfect tonight.
Amplifier from the 1940s?
That's correct.
Hopefully it works. Some of you might not have even been born back in the 40s.
It's older than my dad.
So no, I see Nathan Davis in the back. You're all in your 30s.
Do I have to get down there?
I've never met anyone from Arkansas or Louisiana, wherever. I don't know what you people look like. I don't know if you age well, or an earth like that, I have no idea what you're doing. Ready? Yes, take it over, big man.
All right. I prepared, and I should put prepared in quotes, really, two songs, one happy one and one sad one, and I thought I'd leave it up to the room as to which one they wanted to hear.
Happy.
Oh, happy.
I hear happy. The song It was written about 20 years ago by a band from Texas called the Old 97s. I'm from about 1,000 miles west from here, and if you wanted to work at all as a working musician, you were in a country slash something band. So this is a country rock song.
Thank you.
been alone with you inside my mind. And in my dreams I've kissed your lips a thousand times. I sometimes see you pass outside my door. Hello? Is it me you're looking for? Smile, you're all I've ever wanted, and my arms are open wide. Cause you know just what to say, and you know just what to do, and I want to tell you so much. I love you. I know I told a lot of people that I'm just gonna, you know, roast a pig on, live on stage, Hawaii style, hence the shirt, but that didn't really work out with the weather and all, so I just found this song on my recommended list on YouTube, so we're gonna go with it.
Gems questions on block exams. After a week, I'm the material faculty emphasize the lectures. Then again, I don't attend lectures because they don't provide value. But I'll be tested on, and I'll learn it on them. So after the points, finishes up, we'll take that intermission. Restrooms, food still outside, I'll make my apologies, et cetera, et cetera.
Hi, I'm Florence. So for those of you who don't know, this instrument is called a pipa. It's a Chinese lute. It's kind of the American way of saying it, I guess, if you don't want to try and figure out the pronunciation. This instrument has a history of over 2,000 years, though it didn't always look like this. The neck used to be shaped differently, used to play it horizontally like I'm holding it now. But you actually play it upright like this. It's kind of, people call it an upright guitar sometimes, and you play it with, I don't know if you guys can all see it, but I'm wearing picks on all five of my fingers. And so this allows me to use all five of my fingers, both hands, in kind of manipulating the strings to achieve different sounds and different techniques. And so you're going to see me demonstrate some of these techniques today. Feel free to come up to me with questions afterward. I really love this instrument. I've been playing it for over 11 years. My mom actually teaches this instrument back in Southern California. And so the piece that I'm going to play today, the Chinese name is Cai Mo Gu de Xiao Hu Niang, which in English roughly translates to the girl who gathers mushrooms. it's a fun piece. It originally has words, actually, so if you ever Google it, which I don't know how you're going to Google it, it has a Chinese name, but anyway, if you ever Google it, you'll come across like these adorable YouTube videos of like this little girl singing this song, and there's like an animation of like this girl picking mushrooms for her family, and stuff like that. So I'm playing basically the vocal part to that song with a bit of, you know, instrumental flair to it, so hopefully you enjoy.
Hey, Florence.
For those of you who are curious, the tuning is A D E A.
Thank you.
next up is going to be Jess Malhotra. Before she comes up to play. So med school, that's expensive, huh? How many of you thought that the largest part of your debt would come from these cafeteria prices? Right? People talk about healthcare, and I gotta pay $4 for a small bag of chips over here. Power to the people. What can I change?
The wonderful Jess will be up in a second, but we were going to have a few people from the charity that we're donating to tonight come play, but unfortunately they're 16 and the storm was scary, so they couldn't make it, but instead we're going to play a video that the director recommended we play, just so you guys kind of know what Music Haven is about. Who we're donating to, where your money is going, and why there's such a great group.
Years to have started so many of them and to see them sort of grow up through the program.
I have been with Music Haven since I was 6, so if you do the math, that's 9 years now. I'm at Music Haven a total of 7 hours a week, including my private lesson, 3 hours mentoring, and Fridays orchestra and quartet. I saw somebody playing the violin, and I was like, Mom, I want to play that instrument. And so we went down there and I signed up, and that was basically when it started, you know?
One of my core teaching philosophies is that no matter what you're doing, whether you're playing a Vivaldi concerto or holding the violin, you have to do it really, really well. I believe that when you instill a sense of discipline and excellence, starting from the very beginning, it not only teaches them how to be really good at what they're doing and how to work for being really good at what they're doing, but it also gives them a really strong sense of agency and the power to become really good at anything they want to do.
I love
teaching and the quartet feed one another. I can tell my students, I'm working on this exact same thing in quartet. I hope that they develop their sense of focus and that when they're at Music Haven, they feel like they're in a safe space to be themselves.
You know, for a free after-school music program like ours to have so many students stay for so long is really remarkable. And so the older students that have been in the program 8, 9, 10 years now sort of are really mentors to some of the younger students. And that's a remarkable thing to see.
So, not tiptoeing, this is a tiptoeing sound, watch. Or, but I'd rather kind of feel the ground.
Listen. Next up, we have Nicole McCamus on piano.
Here we go. We're going to move it over.
Groundwork here. I'm sure everyone feels the same as I do, pretty pumped up. Margaret's over here stretching like she's got an MMA fight or something. So my hopes are pretty high. I'm very sorry that David Hill is not here tonight, but I'm sure there's someone else in the crowd who enjoys infectious diseases. So tell me if you enjoy this one. So an infectious disease walks into a bar. And the bartender says, "We don't serve your kind here." And it says, "Well, you're not a very good host." So Margaret, you ready? Okay. You in the splash zone. Watch out in front of a couple words.
Yeah, Marks!
Hey.
Dime si piensas en mí.
besar en otros labios, como me arrepiento. Y se me fue la inspiración desde que tú no estás. Lo que no te pude dar, a otro te lo dará. Lo que me está matando es que nunca regresará.
Heard before. And if you've heard this before, I welcome that you yell out the punchline if you think you know it. But I think this is a very original joke. So here we go. You'll pretty yell out the punchline if you know it. What do you call the person who graduates last in the medical school class?
A doctor.
I was going to say Luke or Jeremy, but... The beauty is, we got two Jeremys, that's all I got. First joke I've ever done this before. A lot of good sports out here tonight. Okay. I call him the king, you call him the pharaoh. Here we go.
So, just a little background, this song is what got me through 3 years of applying to medical school. Lin-Manuel Miranda is one of my favorite musical performers, and his energy in Hamilton to like just go through life and just put 100% of your energy into everything you do is what fuels me every day. So.
Orphan, son of a whore and a Scotsman, dropped in the middle of a forgotten spot in the Caribbean by providence, impoverished and squalor. Grow up to be a hero and a scholar, the $10 founding father without a father, got a lot farther by working a lot harder, by being a lot smarter, by being a self-starter. By 14, they placed him in charge of a training charter. And every day while slaves were being slaughtered and carted away across the waves, he struggled and kept his guard up. Inside he was longing for something to be a part of. A brother was ready to beg, steal, borrow, or barter. But a hurricane came, and devastation reigned. Our man saw his future dripping down the drain. Put a pencil to his temple, connected it to his brain. And he wrote his first refrain, a testament to his fame. Well, the word got around, they said, this kid is insane, man. Took up a collection just to send him to the mainland. Get your education, don't forget from whence you came. And the world's gonna know your name. What's your name, man? Alexander Hamilton. My name is Alexander Hamilton.
And there's a million things I haven't done. Just you wait, just you wait. When he was 10, his father split, full of it, debt-ridden. 2 years later, see Alex and his mother bedridden, half-dead, sitting in their own sick, the scent thick. And Alex got better, but his mother went quick. Moving with the cousin committed suicide. Left him with nothing but ruined pride. Something new inside of voices. And Alex, you gotta live for yourself. You started retreating, reading every tree is on the shade. There wasn't nothing left to do for someone less astute. They would have been damned destitute without a cent of restitution. Started working, clerking for his late mother's landlord. Treating sugar cane and Roman public things.
Hamilton.